la mer qu'on voit danser le long du golfe clair a des reflets d'argent la mer.
If you travel from Sedan in northeastern France, near to the Belgian-Luxembourg border, down alongside the German frontier, across the Moselle and the Saar valleys, towards Switzerland, you will now and again come across strange structures sticking up in the countryside and in fields, hundreds of them, like this thing behind me. If you ask local people, and you're lucky, they will say it's something to do with the Maginot line. Tell me, you know, very broadly, what you know about the Maginot Line.
What I know is that it was an ineffective defense for France after World War I and before World War II.
Ça, je n'en sais rien. Je ne suis pas un stratège militaire.
What do you know? The war ended in.
La ligne Maginot. Je peux pas vous en dire grand chose. Hein, j'étais trop jeune. Hein.
Est-ce que ça marchait?
Ça marchait?
Ouais. Ouais. Okay.
No, c'est tout proche.
Was there a battle there?
No.
No?
No. It was just given up by the French to the Germans.
Est-ce qu'il y avait des batailles ici, la ligne Maginot?
No.
No? So was it a big battle on the Maginot Line anyway?
I don't believe so. I believe it, they came through Belgium and around the back.
It just went around.
The Maginot Line got its name courtesy of the media, who tagged it onto André Maginot, who was Minister of War at the time when they voted the money. He was a popular figure, ex-World War I hero, severely wounded in the leg. And he'd become a politician and a very successful one. But in fact, the line owed much more to Paul Panlevé, who was Minister of Defence from 1924. He was really the architect and financier. Having said that, the Maginot Line was something that many generals and politicians had wanted since almost immediately after the First World War. This might seem rather strange, since the French had just beaten their enemy, the Germans. But in fact, the French had so often been surprised by sudden attacks from Germany that they really wanted some sort of security to make sure it would never happen again. After many studies beginning in 1922, they finally decided that they would build a series of fortresses, the principle of which was they would be interdependent. These would go all the way from the Mediterranean, initially, I suppose, they thought, to the English Channel. In fact, they never reached any higher than a place called La Ferté, near the Belgian border. Of course, the Maginot Line was never intended to be an impregnable fortress the whole length of France. All it was intended to do was to stop any surprise attack rushing straight into the heart of France, as almost happened in the First World War. What they wanted was to hold up the enemy for several days, or perhaps a week or more, to give time for France to mobilize her massive army of 2 million men and rush them to the scene of any threatened region. However, this was not how it was sold to the French people. To them, it was their guarantee there would never ever be a German attack onto foreign soil for the rest of their lives. This kind of propaganda meant that 60 years later, we all believe that this was an impregnable fortress line which failed miserably and which let down the people who paid for it. The Maginot Line did work, insofar that it forced the Germans to choose to launch their attack somewhere between its northern end and the English Channel. This should have made life much easier for the Allied generals, who could have concentrated their mass of material and men in the right place to meet the threat. It's well documented they got it wrong. Their armies were cut in half, the British Expeditionary Force was driven into the sea at Dunkirk, and as far as the British are concerned, that's the end of the story. The rest was simply the immediate fall of France. The real history, and especially the part played in it by the Maginot Line, is rather different. The building of the Maginot Line started in earnest in 1930, and the plan was to have completed the chain by 1943. By the mid-1930s, though, it became clear that Hitler was unlikely to wait, so the problem of lack of money and political opposition was now compounded with one of lack of time to finish the ambitious project. All the original Maginot forts were intended to be designed on the open-hand principle. The nerve centre, or headquarters, would be towards the wrist, and some distance away from potential enemy action. Each finger represents combat and observation turrets of various kinds. Each finger would cover the other, and in heavier engagements, one fort would call down on another for artillery support, often from a fair distance away. This design was intended to make the forts very difficult to storm by conventional artillery and infantry methods. Assuming the enemy could cross or destroy the veritable fields of barbed wire entanglements and anti-tank traps which surrounded each fort, there was the fact that every conceivable angle of approach was theoretically covered by cannon and machine gun. There were anti-personnel mortars and grenade launchers mounted in the roofs and entrance approaches, ready to launch their charges to annihilate any specialist small group, brave or foolhardy enough to attempt such a direct assault. In the event of a particularly heavy artillery or air attack, the defenders would simply shut shop, seal their various shutters and embrasures, and take shelter deep underground. As soon as the enemy put in a mass of infantry to consolidate the position, a phone or radio call would ensure that every available gun from neighbouring forts would open up with a barrage of anti-personnel shells and mortars onto the metres-thick reinforced concrete roof of the threatened fort. The roof of a Maginot fort was intended to be a very uncomfortable place for an unwise invader to be caught. To have some idea of the layout of the large French fortresses, les gros ouvrages, we can do no better than here at Hackenberg, considered the biggest of all the Maginot Line fortresses. The firing turrets were a good 2 kilometres away from this, the entrance. All the large fortresses had two entries, one for munitions, that's the one behind me, and another for the men.